and a perspective of the China's influence on global order and human rights movement and democracy movement in China. Today is the 29th anniversary of Tiananmen democracy movement, Tiananmen massacre. And I'm happy to see here Wang Dan, Xiang Xiaoji, Tong Yi, Zhou Fengshu, Wang Junhao, so all these Tiananmen student leaders and heroes here. So I try to explain how China went from 1989 to 1984, of course the George Orwell's 1984, perfect dictatorship, as Professor Stein Regan analyzed. He also created a new terminology, controlocracy, to describe the current Chinese political system. What happened in 1989 is the democracy movement and Tiananmen massacre, and the Tiananmen massacre actually deeply influenced the economy and political development in China, also the international economic order and international political order. And you know, after the 1989, the fall of Berlin Wall, and then the Soviet Union and communism regimes collapsed, and then it shaped the current political order. And in China, the Chinese Communist Party adopted the market economy officially, of course, as socialism, market economy. And then at the same time, the political system remains one party rule. The party controlled the judiciary, the military, the society, and strictly. So the oppression is there, and China remains one of the worst countries in terms of human rights and political freedom. And of course, it created a lot of dissatisfaction. But on the other hand, there were some new social spaces or the new social resources. Like internet, like market economy, the globalization, the legal professions, and then we can develop our rights defense movement, and so this is a brief picture of how China went from 1989 to 1984. I can elaborate a little bit. This is 1987. By social space, I mean the recovery of legal profession, like lawyers, and a lot of legislations were made locally and centrally. The market economy, the media, especially the new social media, the internet, really play a significant role in the civil society movement, and the dissemination of liberal thoughts in 1990s and after. We can develop the rights defense movement since 2003. So a lot of human rights lawyers and defenders, bloggers and NGOs participated in the human rights movement, and we took all kinds of sensitive cases, human rights cases, and we used all kinds of social movement repertoires. Let me show you some picture of the Wei Quan Yun Dong, the rights defense movement.
like Xiamen PX, the protest against the pollution project, Nanfang Zhoumo, the sudden vacant protest, no support for the freedom of expression and human rights lawyers, who supporting the blind activist in Wang Cheng in front of the local court, and a lot of performance art, street performance, Chen Yunfei, Hu Jia, Tu Fu, and so these grassroots or barefoot lawyers, and lawyers and activists went to Jian Sanjiang and other cities to challenge the black jails. The legal education center actually has nothing to do with legal or education. It's kind of black jail detaining Falun Gong practitioners. And so these four lawyers were detained and tortured, and then more activists and lawyers went to Jian Sanjiang to support these lawyers and citizens. And house churches, underground Christian churches, and Pan Yu protest. And people were there supporting the umbrella movement in Hong Kong. So for the past 3 decades, everyone admitted the China stress is really amazing. And China has now become the second largest economy in the world, and play an aggressive and active role on international space. And of course, there are different reasons behind the China threat, the economic miracle, like investment, like globalization, internet, technology. But many scholars, many people, ignore one of the most important reasons behind the China miracle. That is, Di Ren Quan Yu Si, the advantage of low human rights. I use Professor Qin Hui's term. So it's easy to understand, like Chinese workers don't have the right to organize their labor union, and their working condition is very poor, very low and dangerous, the bargaining power is very weak, and even as Qin Hui analyzed, it's kind of minus welfare in China, fu fu li. Welfare generally means the government takes from the rich to subsidize the poor, but in China actually the government takes more from the poor to subsidize the privileged class, and even there are forced labor, the prison products. So China becomes more and more powerful, and it also influenced the current international order and international economic order and political order. China was allowed to enter WTO. And China was voted in Human Rights Council again and again, and then the Western countries adopted engagement policy. I think it's like an appeasement policy. In 1989, all democracies sanctioned Chinese government, condemned the Tiananmen massacre and supported the activists in prison and in exile. But very soon, the Western countries welcomed the butchers and Chinese dictators with flowers and red carpet, and they can't wait to hug the Chinese dictators. So China has no soft power and soft power or hard power to influence the international order. I can give you a lot of cases. I have my own experience. 3 years ago, when I was at Harvard Law School, ABA, the American Bar Association, invited me to write a book to talk about my own experience and Chinese politics and legal system. But when I signed the agreement, they rescinded the proposal, and they told me to publish my book will endanger their programs in China. So it's a typical case of self-censorship, and lots of other cases like Confucius Institute, the Chinese Student and the Scholar Association, One by One Rules, Yahoo, Apple, Facebook. Actually, Facebook tried everything to enter Chinese market, and Yahoo even provided its client information to Chinese state security, and leading at least three bloggers were sentenced to 10 years and 8 years in prison. Hong Kong, China's manipulation of international human rights mechanism at Human Rights Council, at UN, and of course, Chinese government officially destroyed the one country, two system, the agreement between China and UK in terms of Hong Kong. So Hong Kong's freedom and democracy is in danger now. And then the Chinese government even kidnapped, distanced, and activated and publishers, booksellers in Hong Kong and in Thailand. One of the most famous cases is Gui Minhai. He has a Swedish passport, and he was kidnapped in Thailand and sent back to China and disappeared for a couple of years. And then soon after he was released, he was taken away in front of the Swedish diplomats. Obviously, China violates human rights not only in China but also beyond its borders in Hong Kong, in Thailand, in Asia, in Europe, in the United States. We have documented cases like activists in United States, in New York, in San Francisco, in other countries, were physically attacked by Chinese agent or some other people held by Chinese government. One question remains. That is, China has become the sophisticated totalitarianism. It's not a Mao Zedong style, Stalin style totalitarianism. It's brutal, but it's also adaptable, flexible, and with some beautiful covers, beautiful languages like the 人类共同体, the shared human community, something. And China is pushing human rights with Chinese characteristics, something like that. So it's a sophisticated totalitarianism, and we can see, it seems that market economy, internet, human rights lawyers, and the language of rule of law, and internet, WTO, globalization should lead China to open society, but actually it didn't. So what happened there? Of course, we can discuss a lot of aspects from international relations and Chinese politics. But one thing that is here, how the policy of sanction and isolation to engagement, appeasement. So my own analysis is there are a series of erroneous theories under the China policy. I don't have time to go into the details, so I just give you the three erroneous theories or mistaken presumptions. The first one is market economy or globalization can lead China automatically to open society and democracy. And erroneous theory number two is their tourism. It's like a Chinese government represents China and has its own legitimacy, and it will honor, it will honor its domestic and international commitment. And there is a soft version of theory number two, that Chinese are authoritarian system, but it has been changing rapidly and positively. It has achieved profound progress, and the party will reform, and then they need time and they need goodwill. Last one is, Chinese government pervades the existence of NGO, and to support, cooperate with NGOs will promote rule of law and civil society in China. So, of course, these are wrong, and I hope I have time to elaborate a little bit about this.
Q&A.
Okay, thank you.